Welcome to Tick Boot Camp's podcast. This is episode 3 of our podcast, and the title of this podcast is Tick Picks. My name is Rich Johannesson.
I'm Matt Sabatello.
And today we're going to talk a little bit about pictures of ticks and why ticks should be memorialized, or a picture of a tick that's biting may be memorialized. Now, we all know, Matt, that a picture of a tick is ugly. Regardless of the lighting, the angle of the image, or the size of the tick, you only get ugly. Ticks are not alone. Their cousins, spiders and scorpions, round out a really ugly family tree. Our reaction to ticks and their cousins is part of our encoded defense system. We automatically feel creepy when we see a tick. Recently, Matt, my secretary, shared with me a story about an extreme reaction she had to a tick. Her mother discovered a tick was engouged in her back, and Kathleen was so disgusted by the tick she physically couldn't remove it. She had to call a neighbor to assist her in removing the tick. So the question, Matt, that I think begs to be asked is, why would anyone take a picture of a tick, especially one that's bitten them?
Yeah, as gross as it sounds, it's best to take a photo of the tick and keep it, because you never know when you may need it. So you want to preserve as much information as possible about the tick that has bitten you, and because you may need it down the road, you don't know.
So Matt, when I was bitten by my tick and I called you about what steps I should take, you actually didn't ask me to take a picture of the tick. You recommended that I preserve the tick in a Ziploc bag.
That's right, yeah, because once you preserve it, there are a lot of different things you can do with it. And my immediate reaction was just preserve the tick. You may need it, and who knows what we're going to do with this tick down the road.
And of course, I did share the tick with my doctor's office, with the physician's assistant that I worked with, and we're going to talk a little bit about that later on in the podcast. But Matt, you actually had a really good idea recently about what we should do with the tick. And can you share with our listeners what your recommendation was?
Yeah, so from our research, we found that the University of Rhode Island has a website called Tick Encounter Resources, which allows people who were bitten by a tick and have removed the tick to actually take a photo of it and send it off to them for analysis. So as creepy as it sounds, we took your tick that was about, 6 months old at the time, Rich, maybe, right?
Yeah, well,
It was missing all of its legs, right? It just had its little palps popping out of the front.
Well, the legs were in the bag. They had just fallen off of the tick.
They were still there, but not attached. And when we took it out, I have to say, I didn't think at the time I was going to be affected the way I was. I was so grossed out, I didn't want to go near it. And when I was taking the photo, I was just hesitant to even get close to it with my camera. And it was just such a weird reaction that I felt.
So Matt, let's walk this back. So we discovered this Tick Encounter Resource Center from the University of Rhode Island. And you suggested that I should take my tick out of its Ugh. Drawer, and you wanted to take a picture of it. For what reason?
So if we take the photo of the tick, you can actually send it off to Tick Encounter over at University of Rhode Island. Great free service. And typically within 2 to 3 days, they'll come back to you with a customized report about the tick, what type of tick it is, and the diseases it may carry. So we happened to do it on a Sunday, not expecting much. And, I remember leaving that day and telling you, Rich, you better send me that email as soon as you get it. I can't wait to see it.
All right,
and
so we did send the tick picture or the tick pic to the University of Rhode Island. And why don't you outline for our listeners what we saw first in order to be able to send out the picture. So you took the picture. We opened up the website. And what did we see on the website?
Yep. So you open up the website. It's pretty simple. It's tickencounter.org/tick_testing. Or you can go right to the main site and click on it. And right away it says, is my tick risky? Tick Spotter helps identify the type of tick and assesses the riskiness of your tick encounter. Submit a picture to Tick Spotters and receive a customized reply full of best practice, next steps, and advice in just 1 to 3 days. So we clicked on that link. We answered a couple of questions about the encounter, where we are, our location, attached the photo of the tick, if we knew what kind of tick it was at the time we thought we knew, but we weren't 100% certain. If we knew what age it was, based on an adult, was it a larva tick? When you found it, when you were bitten, and a whole bunch of other questions about geography. Are you in the United States? If so, what zip code and what's your email address?
So Matt, as soon as we filled out that form and you attached the picture to the website, we then got an auto response from the University of Rhode Island's Tick Resource Center.
That's correct. So we immediately got a response on the webpage too that said, thank you for your submission. You'll receive an automated email from us with the tick bite information. If you submitted a picture, we'll follow up with a customized email to help you assess your risk before testing. It generally takes 1 to 3 days for a staff member to review your tick picture and will write an assessment.
Okay, Matt, and then after we got that response, We got another auto response from the Rhode Island Tick and Counter program.
That's right. So I think almost immediately you got an email saying, greetings and thank you for your recent tick spotter submission. And it gave an ID number. So apparently Rich was 57,380, which I take to mean that there's been 57,380 tick submissions of photos through their service.
And at some point, perhaps we should call these folks and see if we can interview them as part of this podcast.
That'd be great, yeah. And they noted that they're currently experiencing high submission volumes, so responses may take longer than 24 to 36 hours to receive. They apologize and encourage us to review their website for more information. And they gave us some basic information about ticks and staying safe with ticks and trying to protect yourself from Lyme disease. So at that point, we figured out we're not going to hear anything back today. It's a Sunday. We kind of, we departed. And what happened then, Rich?
So I had gotten home probably 15, 20 minutes after we had departed, and I had received an email with the analysis.
That's right. So
I forwarded that to you, Matt, and
Yep, I called you right away, and we had to talk about it because we were both very excited about it. So it came back right away that the tick you encountered was an adult female Lone Star tick, which actually you were spot on, Rich, with your prediction on that. And it came back saying that this tick would not transmit Lyme disease to you, Rich, that it actually had a 10% chance of carrying a disease called ehrlichia. And this disease has very similar symptoms to Lyme disease, but it's just another tick-borne disease that you can get from a tick bite. So that 10% chance that was there was very minimal. And of course,
it's minimal. If you don't get it, it's
yeah, it can destroy, it can ruin you. So, as you know.
So Matt, let me just tell you what my reaction was. I do want to share with our listeners what my reaction was. So, of course, for those of you who did not listen to our earlier podcast, and I urge you to, I did share with our listeners my origin story, and my origin story included a visit to the doctor's office to meet with a physician's assistant some 4 days after I was initially bitten. I did call and ask for an immediate appointment, and I was also told that I couldn't see a doctor for over 3 weeks. So when I get to the doctor's appointment, I take out the tick that Matt recommended that I bring with me to the doctor's office. I show it to the physician's assistant. He looks at it. He hands it back to me. I hand it back to him again, and I point out to him that there's a white spot on the back of the tick. He says, that's interesting. He hands it back to me. And I did ask him whether or not the species of the tick would be significant in the way that he would diagnose and treat me, and he said no. So my reaction as soon as I read this report that I had gotten back from Tick Spotters was that I was really pissed off. And the reason I was pissed off is because my anxiety about Lyme disease was really high. And it was really high for a long time because I was concerned about it when I was bitten. I was concerned about it when I had gone to see the doctor. And more importantly, I was concerned about it for a long period of time after I went to the doctor's office, because what I was told was that that the diagnostic testing that was available to me would only provide me with a diagnosis of Lyme disease if I had in fact contracted Lyme disease, that they could only test the antibodies. So I had this 6 week window after I was tested to determine whether or not I had Lyme disease to have another 6 weeks of anxiety. And if this doctor's office and this physician's assistant had any basic level of competence, he would have been able to tell me when he looked at the tick, I was not going to contract Lyme disease. Now, he would have had to tell me that I would have possibly had contracted another tick disease. He may have, warned me to be concerned about some other symptoms that may or may not have happened in a shorter period of time. But I didn't have that. I received the advice that I would be welcomed back and that I should make an appointment to come back in 6 weeks to take a blood test to determine whether I had Lyme disease. So I was really pissed off as soon as I received this report, Matt.
Yeah, and what's most surprising to me, Rich, is, I mean, upon your first Google search for a tick with a spot on its back, which we did, and I'm actually going to pull up, we have a picture of your tick here, and oh, it's just gross. I mean, it's but when you Google this, it's clear that a tick with a spot on its back that looks like that is a Lone Star tick. So if you and I can do a Google search in less than 10 seconds to find that out, wouldn't you think a doctor in an area like Long Island, New York would know what a Lone Star tick is and what type of disease it carries? So it's really scary when you think about that.
Well, Matt, the other piece of this, of course, is I wasn't given the information about the other diseases that I may have contracted from this tick. Now, of course, one of the other concerns that, you know, I should have been made aware of from this doctor was that I could have also contracted a meat allergy, the alpha-gal meat allergy. Now, yes, we know people have died from anaphylactic shock as a consequence of having these meat allergies. Yeah. I was not warned that that there was the possibility that I could have suffered a meat allergy, and I was not warned to be concerned about the symptoms. So not only wasn't I told that I could not have gotten Lyme disease, and not only wasn't I told that there was another disease that would have had symptoms that were similar to Lyme that may have begun to present, but I was also in a position where I could have eaten a red meat meal,
yeah,
and I could have had an allergic reaction to this red meat meal. And what you know, we're starting to see when we look at the research that's being done, or at least the media presentation of this alpha-gal meat allergy, is that there are people who are dying from the meat allergy because they don't recognize that ingesting meat is what's causing the allergic reaction.
That's right. And the scary part is you could ingest red meat and have a reaction hours later. So we've read stories of countless people who have ingested red meat, and hours later they can't breathe, they have this allergic reaction, and they can't figure out why, and eventually, you know, they come to the conclusion that it's from a meat allergy, from a Lone Star tick, but it's not going to be a direct correspondence between I was eating red meat and now I had an allergic reaction. So it's hard to really put the connection there together.
So now the good news about this tick spotter report is it gave us some additional information, Matt. For example, it did give us the gender of the tick.
Yep.
And it also gave us an outline of how long the tick had been. You know,
feeding on you,
feeding on me, you know, before it had been detached. And what the report says is that it appears that this one was attached and feeding for about 1 day or less. Now, that's another piece of information that the doctor should have considered when giving me the advice that he was giving me.
Right.
Because the data demonstrates, or I should say the research data demonstrates, that I would have had to have had the tick feeding on me for at least 24 hours, probably 36 hours for me to contract Lyme disease. So even if this doctor didn't know the species of the tick and didn't know that this species of tick could not have given me Lyme disease and didn't know that this species of tick could have given me other diseases or other allergic reactions that I should have been aware of and taken into consideration during the course of the next few days or weeks of my life. But even more importantly, he could have also put my mind at ease by telling me that the size of the tick suggested it was feeding on me for an insufficient amount of time for me to have contracted Lyme disease, even if it was a Lyme disease carrying tick.
Yeah. And not only that, so this report is really good because it goes on to tell you, Rich, that adult and you know, baby Lone Star ticks can transmit Ehrlichia germs in as little as 6 hours. So that was a bolded red statement in there. But then it went on to note that it's only in 10% of bites from a Lone Star tick is it going to transmit this disease on average.
And that's, I think, that's, but Matt, I think I disagree with you on the 10%. I think 10% is a pretty high percentage, and it's not.
True.
There aren't odds that I would like to take. It's like having a 1 in 10 chance of blowing your brains out if you had a bullet in a gun. I wouldn't take that chance. So
yeah.
So
that's a very good point.
So next paragraph, which you're now reading, of course, caused me to have a negative reaction to my doctor as well. Because, look, we know from the report that we had gotten from the tick encounter that the tick was feeding on me for less than a day. So Lyme disease was off the table. However, we also know that Ehrlichia is a disease that I could have contracted from this particular tick if it had been feeding on me for 6 hours, and the report could not discern whether or not it was 6 or greater hours. So that's information the doctor should have given me,
right,
and that's information that I should have been prepared to take into consideration when symptomology did or did not present itself over the course of the next 6 weeks between the time that I went to see the doctor and the time that I was going to go back for my Lyme test, which again begs another question, Matt. So 6 weeks after my initial visit to the doctor's office, I went back and I took a blood test.
Right.
And I was told that the blood test would then give me the results of whether or not I had Lyme disease or not. And within a few days of me taking the blood test, I don't recall exactly when, how long after, I did receive a call from the doctor's office, and they said, congratulations, Mr. Johannesson, you do not have Lyme disease.
Yep, and I call BS on that, Rich, because as we've learned, these Lyme tests are horribly inaccurate. And, you know, some studies suggest they're over 50% inaccurate, and I tend to believe that. And some other studies suggest they're 80% or higher inaccurate. So it really depends on the type of, you know, the strain of Lyme disease. Not to get too detailed, but there's so many factors that can determine a false,
Well, but Matt, but it begs the question, should I have even taken the test? Right. I know what test I took. I don't know if they tested for Ehrlichia. I don't know if they tested for anything else that they could have tested. But why test me for Lyme disease when A, the tick wasn't feeding on me long enough, and B, the species of tick did not carry Lyme disease?
Right.
Why give me the blood test? So, you know, my reaction when I read the report from the tick encounter at from URI was, no shit, Sherlock. Of course I didn't have Lyme disease because I didn't get bitten by a tick that carried Lyme disease.
That's
so,
right.
You know, even giving me the blood test was, in my view, you know, a waste of my time, a waste of my money, and certainly a waste of my insurance carrier's money. And it was driven by a failure on the part of the doctor's office to have the tools necessary to determine what the proper diagnostic test should be and what the proper treatment protocol should be. Now, of course, the last step in this process, because I did share with our listeners in the past that I was prescribed the course of doxycycline.
Right.
And what the doctor's assistant or the physician's assistant said to me was that if I had gone to his office earlier, I could have received a single dose of doxycycline, and that would have had the same effect of what would turned out to be a 5-day course of doxycycline.
But Rich, didn't you call them the day you were bit?
I did.
They didn't tell you, oh, I'm going to call on a prescription for you for a dose?
Well, and that's, of course, that's one of the issues that we have to talk with our viewers about. There are a couple of, I should say our listeners, there are a couple of prophylactic pieces that could have put in place where I didn't need to visit with a doctor. They could have called in a prescription for doxycycline that day. And we're going to have to talk a little bit about some of the research that's showing that there are some creams that are available.
Yeah.
I think it's a zithromycin cream that would have the same effect if it was put on the spot where the tick had bitten me within 72 hours. It would have had the same effect. So I could have avoided the contact with a doctor.
Yeah.
I could have had a prescription that would have allowed me to have the benefit of the doxycycline immediately. And I wouldn't have had to deal with all of these issues that, you know, that we're talking about here. So this was an absolute failure on the part of my doctor's office, and it certainly was borne out by all the information that we had gotten from the RI results. But so the good news is, folks, that in the event that you're bitten by a tick, if you take a couple of really simple steps, preserving your tick, taking a picture of your tick, uploading your information into the University of Rhode Island site, and then receiving that information back to you before you go to visit with your doctor, you're going to be in a much better position to determine what type of diagnostic protocol should be put in place and what type of prophylactic medications, if any, should be put in place. And that's a wonderful result. So, but now if you look a little bit further down in this report, Matt, they then recommend that you log on to their, they have some hyperlinks here. You hit the hyperlink and it takes you over to their site. And this is where I'll have to tell you that the report had me very unhappy with my doctor. But then when I linked over to the URI site, I felt like I was being waterboarded with information. And this is consistent with a lot of what I was feeling when I was doing my research before I went to the doctor, and then between, you know, the bite and the doctor, and then some of the research afterwards. There's just so much information, and it's so, you know, scientifically oriented,
and it's
so overwhelming that even though I've been doing research for months and months and months now, we've started to do this podcast together, I was overwhelmed when I got to the website. There was just much, much too much information. So I have to thank the folks at the University of Rhode Island for their wonderful service that provided me with a great deal of information very, very quickly. But I have to recommend to them that perhaps they reorganize their site so that when you're looking for actionable information after you get their report, that you can get that actionable information directly connected to your report and in a more understandable format rather than this very academic format that was available.
Here's an example of a heading that we're looking at right now just from clicking on one of the links in the email responses. Transmission dynamics of Borrelia burgdorferi SS during the key third day of feeding by nymphal Ixodes scapularis, Acari Ixodidae. And honestly, I don't know what some of that means, and we've been researching this for quite a while now. So some of them are just scientific names for a tick, like the Ixodes scapularis. But it's really not something you can easily digest. And there's a lot of, it's very intimidating, and it's a lot of information. So, on one hand, you can have information overload, and on the other hand, you can have no information at all, like Rich experienced with his doctor. So there needs to be a happy medium here somewhere. But the University of Rhode Island has a really great service. We really recommend you guys take advantage of that. And if you get bitten by a tick, certainly it's free. Take a picture, send it off to be reviewed, and get that feedback and bring that with you to your doctor. And then use that as a starting point to see what your next steps are to take proper action. It's a really great service, and we recommend you take a look at
it. So now we're going to have to put up a product review on our website. Our website is www.tickbootcamp.com. We'll put up a review of this site, the service, and we'll hopefully give you a quick, actionable way of getting this information through the review that we're going to put up on our site. So I want to, again, thanks to folks from at the University of Rhode Island for this wonderful service. I think it's a great service to the public. I'm Absolutely. Hoping folks in the medical community will begin to use it themselves and to recommend that their patients use this. What I'm planning to do, Matt, is to contact my doctor's office. I'm going to ask them to send me a copy of the blood test that they had offered to me. I'm going to ask them for copies of the doctor's notes, and we'll do another podcast in the future outlining what the tests were, what the results were, and we'll talk about what options folks should consider when they are presented with blood test options. So for now, this is Richard Johannesson and Matt Sabatello signing off on podcast number 3, Tick Picks.